I guess this is a very nice way to have our concluding presentation for the 2017 Laureate season. Naples High School with three Laureate candidates. And now, over 20 years later, we have had as many as 65 from Naples High School, and we have a wonderful, wonderful group this year. So it is my pleasure this morning to introduce Tanner Kelly to you. Laureate Diploma Candidate, a Cambridge ACE Diploma Candidate, and an active member in the Collier County Judicial System. He volunteers at the Collier County Teen Court and was selected for the Sheriff's Office Teen Academy. He is also a member of Junior State of America and Distributed Education Clubs of America, DECA. Tanner is a four-year academic scholar, and he hopes to attend the University of Florida to study finance and political science. We have a wonderful panel here today. Deborah Cantor, who comes from our social studies department, and I hope I get this right today, because I flubbed it last time. Anyway, we have Courtney Stallman, who is the manager of high school career academies for Collier County Public Schools. We have Nicole Litchko, a teacher on special assignment with Collier County Public Schools. We have Ernie Madunio, who is our activities director par excellence here at Naples High School. And we have Beth Jones, a captain with the Youth and Delinquency Service Division from Collier County Sheriff's Department. And we're very happy to have his family and his fan club here. And we thank the tech squad back in the booth. All right, it's all yours, Tanner.
All right, so good morning, everybody. I would just like to begin my Laureate presentation by thanking my panel for being here. I don't see Ms. McKee, but I want to give her a shout out for editing my paper, so I really appreciate that. I see you now. Thank you, Ms. McKee. And I would also like to thank Mrs. Rothering and Mrs. Glancy for their help with this research process. Now, my Laureate question is, what could best be done to improve relations between the police force and the public? But I don't have a PowerPoint. So. That's a good start, right? Improve relations between the police force and the public. Now, my motivation for this was something that a lot of people know, but not a lot of people fully understand. So a few months back, just a block away from my home in Lake Park neighborhood, there was a domestic dispute that occurred. Now, essentially my understanding of the incident was that there was a husband and a wife that got into an altercation, and there was a physical altercation that followed. Now, through this incident, the wife felt threatened enough that she ran outside of the house screaming for help. Now, a concerned neighbor called the police, and a deputy soon arrived on scene. Now, the deputy noticed some superficial wounds on the face and the neck of the victim, i.e. the wife, and instructed the husband to sit down on the curb and to be still and just to wait. Meanwhile, the deputy went over to the wife and attempted to help her out with these. Now, while the deputy was distracted, the husband, the assailant, went inside, grabbed the pistol, and shot himself. Now, this is an issue that cannot be ignored, and it is something that touched my heart very deeply because of the proximity to my home, as well as the fact that any human should be worried about this. Now, without a doubt, it cannot be claimed that it's the officer's fault for this tragedy, and this is not something that's commonplace, but it's something that, without a doubt, plagues our hearts and our minds. Now, the prevalence, as on the second bullet point here, is that this is an issue that is seen in social media such as Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, on newspaper headlines, in television news, and even in the presidential campaign through political debates. Now, a couple of key terms that I would like to define are, number one, community policing, which is essentially where the police force must match the demographics of the community. This aims to eliminate issues such as prejudice and racism. Furthermore, community outreach programs are another way that these tensions can be alleviated because it allows law enforcement officers to engage in non-law enforcement activities with civilians so that they can forge a trusting relationship with them. Now this is a quick video that I would like to show that analyzes how the Los Angeles Police Department, one of the most infamous police departments in our nation, has aimed to help out these tensions.
We have had two high-profile cases this summer of unarmed black men dying in confrontations with white police officers. The federal government is investigating the police department in Ferguson, Missouri, after the shooting death of Michael Brown. And today, New York Police Commissioner William Bratton announced officers will get annual training in the use of force following the chokehold death of Eric Garner. Bratton once served as the police chief in Los Angeles, helping to institute reforms that continue there today. John Blackstone now on what other police agencies can learn from the LAPD.
It's a normal busy day for LAPD officers in South Los Angeles. But in the public housing projects of the Watts neighborhood here, police seem as determined to make friends as they do to make arrests. Officer Tiffany Norwood serves in what is called the Community Safety Partnership.
These kids look up to us as a mentor, a father figure, a mother figure, a close auntie.
It's a change from how police were seen here less than a decade ago.
The relationship back then was hostile. There was mutual disrespect. There was mutual fear.
Is there a crime involved in that?
Captain Philip Tingerides took command of the community police station here in 2007. He led his officers in changing attitudes and changing language.
There's a difference between telling somebody, hey, can I talk to you? And, hey, get over here.
Two decades ago.
All right, so what that video aims to discuss is the ways that law enforcement officers are taken into their own hands to alleviate these tensions. So while this does seem like just a civil issue, just a social issue, it's really not. When examining the science and technology aspect of this problem, we see things such as the technological advances in police work. Now, one of the most well-known and one of the most important and prevalent types of technological advances are body cameras, which is that right there. And this is fairly straightforward. It's just a portable audio and video recording device that allows officers to record their actions, as well as the actions of a suspect or criminal or just anyone that they come in contact with. Now, I know that, for example, in Collier County here, all deputies that are on patrol must wear these. Now, I think this is a very important policy that has been made, and it's something that should be instituted further. Now, the importance of the body cameras lies in the fact that both parties that are involved are held responsible for their actions and their words. There is no he said, she said type of thing that comes into play, but rather everything is recorded and everything can be used as direct evidence in a court of law. As well as body cameras, there is a computer software program called Predictive Policing. Now what this does is every crime that goes reported, even if it doesn't go to trial, is marked on a map. This is a computer software program that allows these crimes to be located so that police can place more patrol vehicles or know where crimes are more likely to happen and so that these can be prevented. Now this was used mostly in Baltimore and Santa Cruz, where it was noted that this greatly helped the tensions. However, people that are not aware of these predictive policing measures fear that there are more patrol officers in one area or one city than there are in another, and this leads to the misunderstanding between the police force and the community because they fear that they are being either racially profiled or they are being prejudged based on their socioeconomic class. And this is simply not the case, but rather it is the predictive policing methods that are being used. Furthermore, the tactics and training assessments that are used in the police force are vital to the success and the maintenance of a healthy relationship. Now, one of the predominant factors of the tactics and training that they use is that they identify ways that a police officer can deal with the situation using non-lethal force. Now, this can be anything from a verbal command to having a discussion between the police officer and the suspect, per se, or it can range all the way up to tasing or something else of that nature. Now, Beth Jones, who's a member of my panel that I was lucky enough to be able to conduct an interview, enlightened me on the fact that here in Collier County, it is required that the deputies and other members of the Collier County Sheriff's Office go under an annual training assessment. Now, I think that this is a wonderful step that Collier County has taken to alleviate tensions between the police force and the public. Now, the reason that these techniques are so important is because that whenever we hear of issues with the police or police brutality in particular, it's usually when someone has died. It's usually, be them innocent or not, it is usually when there's been a killing that has been heard. Now, if police officers are more aware of how they can use non-lethal methods of force, then hopefully these deaths will decline. So bringing to the ethical dilemma that is present in this issue, which in my opinion is by far the most controversial part of my topic, a few factors must be considered. One thing that's not thought of very often is domestic violence in the homes of police officers. Now, the National Center for Policing researches this heavily. While the National Center for Women in Policing do not claim that this is a common issue or necessarily one that deserves nationwide recognition, it is something to be considered. And the main issue here with domestic violence in the home of a police officer is that, for example, if a male police officer who was the husband in the household was abusing the wife might be reluctant to call any authorities on scene because, number one, there's a greater chance that the abuser will be either friends or at least colleagues or acquaintances with whoever responds to the scene. More so, a police force might be more reluctant to follow through with the trial that could have occurred through this because it makes the department look bad. Because if police are there that are to serve and protect our community, but they cannot serve and protect their own household, well, that's an issue we can all agree on. Furthermore, one of the most high-profile incidences with police brutality was in Ferguson, Missouri. Now, this occurred in 2014 with the killing of Michael Brown. The Department of Justice deemed the situation so severe that they launched an investigation into it after there was rioting, looting, and other forms of issues that arose from it. Now, it got to the point where martial law had to be instituted in St. Louis County. Now, martial law, for those who aren't familiar with it, is there's a curfew for every individual, so you're not allowed to be out after a certain time. There are issues that arise with ways that military personnel must be brought in to deal with the issue because of the violence that was occurring. Now, while this does seem like a US-centered issue, it's really not. For example, in Ivry, France, there was an incident where the police departments wanted police reform nationwide. They wanted to alleviate these tensions, and they were being proactive in doing so. However, the federal government was not allowing them to institute reform on the scale that they wanted to. So the officers banded together with protesters that were just civilians, and they led an officer-led protest to try to bring greater awareness and to make it a more important issue for the federal government to see. Now, while this may seem like a noble cause, it didn't work out. There was a militant force that came in and ambushed these people while they were peacefully protesting. Now, it did seem, as I said, as a noble cause, and it did seem like a step in the right direction. However, this is not the way that it must be done. Just because the police force and the public agreed that something must be changed does not mean that there are not certain techniques and methods that need to be done to go about this. Furthermore, the political aspect of my topic brings into things that are also not thought of very often. For example, in political campaigns, such as seen in the presidential election of 2016, there was great security personnel present at all rallies. Now, security personnel are there for exactly what you would think, for security, to maintain peace. However, the National Public Radio, an unbiased news source, states that the police and campaign rallies only serve for security purposes. Now, while this seems intuitive and it seems obvious, it's really not. Because, for example, If an individual or a group of individuals are so opposed to a candidate such as Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, and they try to go in and protest against this at the rally, they may be intimidated by the security personnel that's there to the point where they feel that their First Amendment rights are being impeded upon. And this is something that can't be had because United States of America, these are some of the values that we hold dear to our hearts. Furthermore, the Secret Service, which we are all aware of and familiar with, had to come out and make a statement that they have a, quote, lack of vested interest or involvement in any political affairs. Now, this is important to consider because the Secret Service guard the president 24/7. Therefore, they're there when all national secrets are shared, they're there when decisions are made, and they're there every time that the president is acting in his power and his jurisdiction. This is something that must be considered because these people know a lot more than any of us do. And if they were out and they were to spread their opinions or they were to leak information from this, it would become a serious issue. Now, the environment surrounding the police force is a tentative one. When speaking on community policing, Chris Kondiak, who works for the Department of Justice's Community-Oriented Policing Services, says that, quote, these trust-building, non-enforcement activities cost little in terms of money, time, or effort, but they pay huge dividends in public safety. What he's speaking to here is that law enforcement officers that come in to situations, they don't have to, they're not there to make arrests, they're not there to press accusations, they are merely there to meet people, to meet civilians, so they can forge a better relationship with them. Now, oftentimes, this is seen with the youth, such as the Youth Relations Department here at Naples High School. Furthermore, the global level of violence surrounding the police force is a difficult one to see. As shown in the graphic here, lethal weapon deaths at the hands of police officers in the latest available year, which upon further research was 2015, showed that Japan and Britain had zero deaths at the hand of police officers, Germany had 8, and America skyrocketed to an astounding 409 civilian deaths at the hand of police officers. Now, without a doubt, I would say that most of us can agree that the United States has a culture of violence. We glorify it, it's in our movies, in our video games, and it's just seen in daily life. So that is something to be considered, but there has to be something else that's occurring to account for the difference between 8 and 409. All four of these countries presented are developed countries, they're first world countries, they communicate with each other, they're part of the United Nations, but there is still something different to account for the 401 death difference. Now, besides the environment, the culture of policing is perhaps an even more tentative subject. Now, it seems that it would be an easy end-all, be-all method to alleviate these tensions by just implementing reform throughout the police force, nationwide and hopefully worldwide. However, it's not quite that easy. The strain of policing by department relies on the fact that it's difficult to implement widespread reform when departments vary by size and demographics. So, for example, what may work in Collier County obviously would not work in St. Louis County. What may work to help a few dozen officers may not work in a place such as Baltimore, Santa Cruz, Chicago, other places like that. Now, one thing that all police departments have in common is they have a top administrator, for example, a police commissioner or a sheriff. Now, what I believe is that all reforms that are implemented in a police department must be led by this top administrator. Furthermore, civil rights activism comes into play here. The civil rights activist Marion Wright Edelman speaks on the issue saying that you have to have a fundamental change in the culture of policing and who is the police person. How do they change? How do you learn from England and the other places or Australia? In England, they don't carry guns on the whole. It's a different kind of mentality that's not demonized and is justified on race and income and class. Now, what she's speaking to here is something that many of us think may be an outdated issue, the issue of racism in the police force. However, anyone who watches the news or keeps up with the times knows that this is not an issue that has gone away. Now, the last sentence of her quote speaks to me dearly because it says that it is justified on race and income and class. Now, as I said in the predictive policing issue, where people feel that they are being racially or economically profiled and therefore having more police officers around, it brings issues to where when they feel that they are being prejudged without the officers even knowing them, there's no way that tensions can be alleviated or improved. Furthermore, a topic that is also not thought of in police culture is gender roles. Now, Leslie Bikos, a former Canadian police officer and doctor of sociology, ran a study of 15 Canadian women officers who said that they, quote, felt disadvantaged in their job based solely on their gender. Now, the flaw in this study was that they did not identify why they felt disadvantaged, only that they did. So it is left open to interpretation, but through my extensive research, it is in my opinion that the female officers felt that they could not intimidate per se, or they could not exert as much authority as, say, a male officer could in a desperate or violent situation. Now, without a doubt, a female police officer has no less authority, intimidation, or power in any situation where an arrest must be made. So this is a flaw in the system, but it is one that must be addressed. Now, this video that I'm going to show here is where a former police sergeant from Baltimore, Maryland speaks on his opinion on police culture. His name is Michael Wood Jr., and he served in the Baltimore Police Department for 11 years.
Wood Jr. left the force a year ago after 11 years on the job. He says he left because he got injured on the job. Now his Twitter account is getting a lot of attention.
We have a culture problem, and it's not that, it doesn't seem like we're consciously thinking about it.
From patrol officer to a supervisor under several Baltimore City police commissioners, Michael Wood Jr. says he witnessed corrupt and dirty police work too often. Here's a few examples of his tweets since Wednesday. A detective slapping a completely innocent female in the face for bumping into him coming out of a corner chicken store. Targeting 16 to 24 year old black males essentially because we arrest them more, perpetuating the circle of arresting them more. Jacking up and illegally searching thousands of people with no legal justification. Another story he tweets about involves him having a suspect cuffed on the ground when a fellow officer came running around the corner.
And full force kicks him right in the face, wells up his face, instantly, like, and I didn't know what to do again. I just knew I wasn't going to be associated with it, so I reached down, took my handcuffs off, and then he left.
Wood says police treat their job like a war, us versus them. But over time, he gained empathy for citizens. He's only getting attention, he says, because of his recent tweets. But he says he's been a champion of police reform for a while. And the culture of silence among officers is a big problem.
The vast majority of the department is just doing what they think police do. It's not that there's some mass conspiracy or anything like that. This is just policing. It doesn't matter whether you're...
Now, what Michael Wood Jr. is speaking to here is the fact that, and something that I found very important to consider, is that this is not a mass conspiracy. It's not that there's corruption in the police force, but rather, it's an issue where an individual police officer feels that just because of their employment and just because of their status, that they are more authoritative over the individual citizens and that they hold precedence over them. Now, this is not the case, and it cannot be argued that this is the case, because, as Michael Jr. would go on to explain in that video, that the police culture is not one that is violent. They're not here to hurt us, they're not here to harm us or to perpetuate the system of racism or prejudice. However, they are just here to protect and to serve the community. Now, my judgment in this is quite simple. I believe in that actions must be taken to change this. This is not something that the United States and the world can just let go on. This is something that must be addressed and must be addressed now. Now, I believe that it's going to take police reformation individually by department. There's nothing that can be done quite nationwide or definitely not worldwide to alleviate this. So I believe that it is the responsibility of each police department to examine the issues that they have, because all police departments have their own problems and their own specific issues, so that they can alleviate the tensions and they can take a step in the right direction in helping out everybody. Furthermore, I think there's a necessary change in opinion that needs to occur on both parties' sides. I believe that the police force needs to remember that their job is to protect and to serve the community. Meanwhile, I believe that it is also important for the public to realize and to remember that they are here to protect and to serve, that there is no mass conspiracy. While there might be corruption in a few specific police departments, this is not widespread, that they are here to help us out. I think that one way that we could do this is through open communication. Now, further on in my research, I did have the opportunity to interview a former Collier County Public School student who, just less than a week ago, was arrested on the charge of battery whenever he hit a guy who was trying to sexually harass his 13-year-old sister. He said that, and I quote, "Understanding that I broke the law, I believe that the system should really start considering personal thoughts on the situation to determine punishment instead of following routine rules for the punishment, because even something so little can mess up a kid's life." Now, I believe that if a police officer were to be able to sit down before the situation occurred and talk to him about these types of things, if there was more community outreach, then hopefully it wouldn't have happened. hopefully he wouldn't be in jail right now and he wouldn't be on the path to probation. Now, I believe that it is important that we have this open communication in order to alleviate the tensions between the police force and the public. Now, a few more solutions that can be seen are community policing. For example, in Singapore, a small Asian country, this is the only type of policing that they have. There is a police academy that simply serves to train volunteers so that they can adequately protect their communities. However, this ensures not only that the demographics of the police force will match that of the community, but that they are there for the right reasons. The police officers that are being trained and that are coming forth are there solely to protect and to help out the community. Now, community outreach programs, which I'm very familiar with, because there's me, not smiling, in the Collier County Sheriff's Office Team Academy, which occurred last June, which I was lucky enough to be selected out of four students in Naples High School to attend, really enlightened me and opened up my eyes to this issue. Now, this was another reason in my motivation that I was so important, that it was so important to consider this problem. Now, throughout this week that occurred last June, I spent 40 hours with mainly Deputy Arnold, who's kind of like the Deputy Brown equivalent at Barron Collier High School. And we went through a training session a modulated training session that the police officers go through so that we can gain a better understanding of how everything works. I think this is one of the most pivotal solutions that can be put forth and set forth so that these issues can be alleviated. Furthermore, Michael Odysseus, who is the president of the International Policing Association, which is an organization of 400,000 police officers worldwide, set forth three guidelines that almost all police departments can follow to help these tensions. His first guideline is number one, courtesy towards citizens. Now, most of my presentation has been about this, so I don't really feel the need to expand on it much more, but this shows that there must be mutual respect here. In the Los Angeles Police Department video that I set forth, that I showed you, the sergeant that took over in 2007 mentioned the difference between asking someone, hey, can you come over here, and hey, get over here. Now, this is something that's important because if there's not mutual respect between the police force and the public, there's no way that these tensions can be alleviated. Furthermore, his second guideline sets forth that appropriate handling of suspects, criminals, and prisoners must be paramount. Now, it is custom now in policing that when a person is handcuffed, that there is a double lock that is instituted. Now, what this does is not only does it not allow the person to break out of the handcuffs so that they can escape, but it also sets forth that their wrist cannot be, like the handcuffs cannot be constricted to where it could impede on the blood flow of the wrist. Now, this is important because no one is going to trust the police and no one is going to truly feel safe if they feel that they are endangered when they are being arrested. The third and last guideline that Michael Odysseus set forth is an increase of professional efficiency. I think this is very important because in an issue such as what occurred in Ferguson, Missouri, there is no sense of comfort or no sense of help that can be provided to a grieving family when the Department of Justice investigation takes years to complete. Now, without a doubt, it's a complex issue. All these cases are different and unique in their own respects. However, when these things take too long and when they don't follow through in a timely manner, it just creates frustration and it could possibly lead to apathy for this issue, which is something else that cannot occur. Now, youth relations is also one of the most important solutions set forth. Mrs. Beth Jones that I was lucky enough to interview stated that many criminals would not speak to just any cop, but opened up to the youth relations deputy. I think this is probably the most important type of solution that can be set forth because it allows the police officers to forge trusting relationships with young kids that will grow up and will be community leaders later. And if these relationships can be forged and the people feel that they know their police officers and they can see the person in the uniform, not just the badge, nor just the gun on the hip, then hopefully they will be able to have more respect and they will be able to not have as many tensions with the police officers. Thank you.
Watch him just drop to the floor.
Thank you, Tanner. And now your panel will ask you some questions. So in the audience, please, if you would remain quiet so we can hear the panel's questions and Tanner's responses. Thank you.
Thank you. Tanner, you're either the most popular guy at Naples High School, or this is one of the subjects that a lot of people wanted to hear about. But yeah. Anyway, I have a question for you. And you had mentioned that, in your opinion, changing the culture should be changed from the figurehead of the police department or the sheriff's office or the law enforcement agency. With that in mind, and changing the culture with those stressors or those strains, as you indicated, including gender, including policy, including racism, things like that, that the police culture sometimes engulfs. What do you think the police head or the leader of those police agencies should do to change the culture? What are some of the examples that you can give that they should do to change the culture?
I think that issue is quite simple, to be honest with you. For example, in my involvement in the Collier County Sheriff's Office Teen Academy, I got to meet the sheriff, Kevin Rambos. I think that this is vital because there is a complete difference between seeing signs on the roads, vote for so-and-so for sheriff. I think that when people get to go out and meet the person that is spearheading the police department, I think that this allows us to forge a better relationship with the police force and therefore the police force with the community. Now, I also believe, as I stated, that the top administrator is responsible for instituting reform. And I believe that people would be more willing to help out with this reform and more accepting of the things that are going on if they knew the person behind the badge.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
You're pretty comfortable with the microphone in your hand. You did a great job with your presentation.
Thank you.
Okay, Naples High School is in the city of Naples, the only high school in the city of Naples, and we're also in Collier County, so we have two different law enforcement agencies really that serve the Naples High School community. You live in Lake Park, so you're served by Naples Police Department. You participated in the Collier County Teen Academy, so you have some involvement with the Sheriff's Department. In your opinion, I'm gonna put you on the spot here, is there a difference in the way that the, is there a difference between the relationship of the community with the Naples Police Department and with the Collier County Sheriff's Department? And if you're, in your opinion, if there is, what is that difference and why are those differences like that?
I would say that there is a great disparity in the public opinion that occurs between the community's involvement with the Naples Police Department and in that of the Sheriff's Office. I believe that it is the widespread opinion that the Naples Police Department is more so, quote, corrupt. And I think that a major issue for this is because of the fact that not too long ago, I don't have the exact date because this wasn't covered in my research, there was a news story leaked that a former sergeant from the Naples Police Department came out saying and speaking on the arrest quotas and the ticket quotas that were to be instituted. There have not been these types of scandals that have been as public and as widespread acknowledged in the Sheriff's Office. Moreover, in my own personal experience, I've never had a positive interaction with a Naples police officer, with a Naples Police Department officer. However, I've never had a negative interaction with the Collier County Sheriff's Office. Now, this could be through my extensive involvement in the Teen Academy, but I believe that it is also the opinion of many other minors and many other young adults that have grown up in this community that the Sheriff's Office is more so here to serve the community, and the Naples Police Department is more so here to just try to keep everything subtle, to keep everything low-key, if you will, as opposed to letting people live their lives.
Okay, that was pretty frank. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi, Tanner. You did a wonderful job. I particularly liked your PowerPoint and how you just had bullets in your speech was great. I loved it. A couple questions for you. The first one, in your PowerPoint, you had some staggering numbers about civilian deaths with the US versus Japan and Britain and Germany. It's just staggering. How accurate, or what sources did you use to determine those numbers? I mean, do they report all of their police incidents, do you think?
They do. I can go back to the slide if you'd like, to where it shows the source. But of course, there are instances of crime where they're not all reported, however the deaths are. that's not something quite that can be covered up. And while this was a U.S. source that was mentioned, so perhaps in other countries, they cannot accurately depict all of the occurrences that happened, it is something still that I believe deserves a lot of merit. The source here was from The Economist, which is a U.S.-based news source.
Great, thank you. And then my other question was, you talk about the body-worn cameras in your presentation in your paper, and I have a little quote here from your paper. The article could have better covered specific instances where body-worn cameras played a direct role in crime. So my question to you is, I know you discussed how they can be a positive. What do you think are the negatives of that?
Well, I think the only type of negative thing that could occur from the use of a body camera is when someone forgets almost that they have it on, and so their actions are not necessarily what are socially acceptable. Because when people are being filmed and they're being listened to, everyone will always tend to gravitate towards the societal norm. And so I think that this could be negatively impacted because there could be times, such as in a domestic violence situation, where if a police officer is responding to the scene, the victim of the abuser may be more likely to say, oh no, it's fine, like it was a false alarm, like everything's okay, when that's not necessarily true. So the limitations of body cameras are that sometimes people will lie or they will downplay the situation so that no arrests are made, so that the situation is not worsened. But I think the advantages of having all police officers and all police officer involvements recorded heavily outweighs any limitations of it.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Great job, Tanner. I really appreciate the personal stories that were brought into this. I thought it enhanced the presentation and the paper, so I want to commend you for both the paper and the presentation. You did a phenomenal job. My question to you is, how do you feel that Collier County ranks in the relationship between the public and the police amongst the United States, both the police department and the sheriff's office?
Well, I'm going to group the sheriff's office and the Naples Police Department in my answer. And I was born and raised in Naples. I've never had any involvement with any police officer outside of Naples. However, I have a group of friends that in August moved to Los Angeles. And they believe that when they were in Naples, they felt that they were this entire group is young African-American males. And they believe that they were targeted just for the way that they look, that they were accused, and that there was a cycle perpetrating, not necessarily racism, but definitely prejudice. And I spoke to one of them on the phone just yesterday because he knew my lawyer was coming up today, so he was calling to wish me luck. And I asked him, I said, well, what do you think of Los Angeles? Because I know the LAPD is one of the most infamous police departments in the history of the country, especially dating back to the Rodney King riots. And he said, well, they're pretty chill. He said, we feel that we have a better relationship with them, not only because of the matching demographics, because there are more African-American and Hispanic officers, but because overall, they don't seem to target these people, they don't seem to target us in the same way that they did back home in Naples.
Do you feel as though our police and sheriff's department utilize the community policing that you were talking about?
I think that, and my research didn't really cover our specifics, I just had my personal knowledge about the community outreach program, so that's what I focused mostly on. But I believe that, I mean, I did extensive research on this, and I consider myself fairly aware of current events, and I feel that if the sheriff's office or the Naples Police Department is adequately using community policing, then we would hear more about it. So my answer is going to be no. I don't think they are adequately utilizing it.
Great answers. Thanks, Tina.
Thank you.
Great job. I'm very proud of you. You look very professional. It was a great sociology topic, and we've talked about race and income before. What role do you think that the media, news outlets, and social media play in the portrayal of police? Because it seems like when something negative happens, and I'm not minimizing 409 deaths that have occurred in the United States, but when something negative happens, that's all we hear about. But on any given day, there are thousands of law enforcement members across the nation that have saved someone's life or intervened in a domestic dispute and saved a child or found a child or something like that. And we don't hear about the good things so much. So personally, I see that media is to blame for a lot of the perception that society has. What do you think about that? And what did you find anything about that in your research?
In my research, no. My research question had nothing to do with media, really. But it is in my own personal opinion that in my senior year, I've heard of one positive action of a police officer, and that was the coffee with the cop that we discussed in sixth period. That's the only thing that I've heard, to be honest with you, that the media has portrayed. And so that everything else is negative. It's either the death or the brutality or racism or prejudice. And I think that without a doubt, media's sole purpose is to report on important events. And I think these are important events. These are tragedies. These are things we must be focused on. But I would agree with you that media has given the police force a bad reputation per se, because they do only focus on these. So I think that if it was possible to implement more news stories about the positives that police go through, maybe this hatred would not be so widespread.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions from the panel? All right, we open this to the audience.
Hi, Tanner. Good morning.
Good morning, Jason.
That was a beautiful presentation.
Thank you.
So, first question, how would you feel about your best friend becoming a cop? And would you be opposed to disliking that?
Absolutely not. I think that it would be a great idea for my best friend.
All right.
To become a cop. Because I think that my best friend would have an understanding and would value my opinions and hopefully could share my opinions with the rest of the police force and hopefully alleviate this issue, because my stance is not that I want to perpetuate a circle of hatred. That's not what I want. I want these tensions to be fixed, and I think that my best friend can do anything.
Of course, I appreciate that.
I appreciate you.
And then the second question, I want your true, honest, unfiltered opinion on law enforcement. Go.
I'm not a fan.
That's it. All right.
Appreciate
it. All right, I saw another question. What would you like to do with this
passion? Is that really your
best friend? This whole presentation.
Well, in the beginning, in the biographical blurb that Ms. Glancy said, it was reported that my dream was to attend the University of Florida, which it still is. I was admitted, thank God. And that I wanted to study finance and political science. Now, I still do want to study political science. However, I kind of threw the finance thing under the bus through my research of this topic, because it is my goal to be able to, I've made it my goal in life to be able to alleviate these tensions. And so, be that through Washington, D.C., be that through the Senate or through Congress, I've made it my life's goal, and it is my passion to alleviate these tensions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, any other questions from the audience? I thought I saw, yes, right here. Great job, Tanner. Me and Max are proud parents. my question is, in your research, what was the most heartbreaking story of police brutality that you came across, other than the suicide in your neighborhood?
It's a loaded question. My topic really isn't police brutality, so that's not what I research or focus on, but I would still have to say that it's tied pretty much between the Rodney King beatings in Los Angeles in the 1980s and the issue that was stated in one of my videos where people in Baltimore were being targeted solely on their race. And there was no other reason, there was no reason why a man who was handcuffed on the ground needed to be ran up on and kicked in the face. That honestly probably hit me deeper than anything, because I was just appalled to hear that. And not many things surprise me anymore. Thank you.
Well, the lunch bell has rung, and we thank you for our